That can be typed, but it isn't visible. It is visible here. What you wrote is visible. भद्रं कर्णेभिश्रृणुयामदेवाः भद्रं पश्येमाक्षभिर्यजत्राः स्थिरैरङ्गैस्तुष्टुवागुंसस्तनूभिः व्यशेमदेवहितं यदायुः स्वस्ति न इन्द्रो वृद्धश्रवाः स्वस्ति नः पूषा विश्ववेदाः स्वस्ति नस्तार्क्ष्यो अरिष्टनेमिः स्वस्ति नो बृहस्पतिर्दधातु। ओम शांति शांति शांतिः। ओम सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। आत्मानम् अरणिं कृत्वा प्रणवञ्चोत्तरारणिम् ज्ञाननिर्मथनाभ्यासात् पाशन्दहति पण्डितः। सो देर् इस् ए लाङ्ग् ट्रेडिशन् आफ् यूसिङ्ग् द ओङ्कार एस् ए आलम्बन। आलम्बन मीन्स् वाट्? एस् ए मीन्स्। And what is the means here? Om. What is to be revealed using the Om? Om. So it is the Vachya. It is that which is to be understood. It is the Vachaka. It is the object as well as the means. Because everything is Brahman, correct? It is the object as well as the means. So this sound symbol, I told you there are two kinds of symbols. Pratima. Pratima means that which is a form symbol, like swastika, like even a form, whether it's the cross or whether it is a form of Bhagavan, any form of Bhagavan, it's a form symbol. And here, unlike that, this is a sound symbol. And we'll see why. Now, there is a long tradition. See, already we are doing adhyasa in our daily lives, correct? Starting from the small adhyasa. What is adhyasa? Let's make sure we know. Superimposition. Starting with the small adhyasa of seeing a snake on every rope, correct? To the big adhyasa of feeling that somebody doesn't like me or whatever it is all just a continuum, all right? So now, since we are experts, we are adhyasa kushalaha, we are experts in adhyasa. So what, the meditation is also another adhyasa, because in any case, that which is beyond time, beyond space, beyond everything, how are you going to represent it through any particular thing, correct? So any form that you use, any sound that you use, any word that you use is going to be adhyasa alone. And here we are in our comfort zone, because we are experts on adhyasa. So it's like the rishis took pity on us and say, go ahead, do one more adhyasa, only with a small difference. This adhyasa is the final adhyasa, which removes all other adhyasa, correct? In fact, all meditation is an adhyasa. And shamelessly, the Shastra herself says, you know, what is adhyasa? the definition of adhyasa again in the Brahma Sutra given by Adi Shankara is atasmin tad buddhi. Tad buddhi, tat means what?
That.
That buddhi in atasmin, in not that. So whenever you have that buddhi in that which is not that, this is adhyasa. So when you have snake buddhi in the non-snake, whether it's a hose pipe, whether it's a curving stream of water, or whether it's a rope, it is non-snake, correct? So that is adhyasa. So atasmin tad buddhi is the definition of adhyasa. Very interesting. So meaning, seeing the not that thing in a particular thing, you know? Yeah. Seeing the buddhi in the non-that location. All right? So, and in fact, this is something shamelessly encouraged by the Shastra. And the Shastra herself says that for those who are not very, you know, what's the word for it? Not great adhikaris. Adhikaris means people who are qualified for the knowledge. They are not yet adhikaris. And so for them, they need something to hold on to. And if for such people, they are told that you are everything, you are beyond time, space, their eyes will glaze over. Correct? Yeah. They are like, what? What are you talking about? You know? And so therefore, for them, the Shastra has devised a wonderful method. And it says that you just superimpose. You superimpose Bhagavan, you know. Imagine, this is the beauty of this tradition. You superimpose something which is all power, all knowledge, onto a small little piece of stone and call it Vishnu. Saligrame Vishnum Dhyayet. In the little stone found in the Himalayas with some insignia of what is attributed to Vishnu. Some shell will be there and some swirling chakra will be there. It is called Saligrama. That's because the Himalayas were the ocean, because India was part of Africa. That is what they say, thousand years ago. And then this piece of land broke off and then collided in this whole Tibet and all these regions. And the collision created these Himalayas. And then that's why you find sand and shells in the Himalayas. That's why. And so these fossilized shells, they have the insignia of what is considered sacred insignia of Vishnu. And those stones are not just called stones, they are called Saligrama. So Saligrame Vishnum Dhyayet. In this small little stone that has been carved by a little creature, you know, going round and round. Please invoke who? Mahavishnu, the sustainer of the universe. This is the beauty of seeing Bhagavan as in everything. So any one thing can represent the whole. Because any one thing will be atasmin only. But that tat buddhi can be put in everything. Because that tat happens to be in every name is tat. Every form is non-separate from tat. And so what is the definition of this, meditation? Upasana itself has a definition. Upasana means meditation. The definition of upasana is also interesting. Utkrishta vastuni utkrishta vastum adhyasya dhyayet. Dhyayet may one meditate. How? On a lowly thing. Superimpose an exalted thing. Nikrishtam means lowly thing. Like this piece of stone with a carving of a chakra or a shell, a conch shell. And then, so that is a lowly thing because you can find it anywhere you go in the Himalayas. You know, and all the people who pick it up on the roadside, sell it on the roadside, they pick it up and sell it. You can find it. You can choose one for yourself and one for your friends and bring it back. People do this normally. And nobody says, thank you for bringing me stone. Immediately the adhyasa is done. Thank you for bringing me Mahavishnu. They receive it with great care and they do puja to it every day. So, they very ritualistically they worship. So, nikrishta vastuni, in that lowly object, you know, do avahanam, invocation of the most exalted thing, utkrishta vastunaha, adhyasa. This is a clean adhyasa, really. But thankfully, it's the ultimate adhyasa that removes. Omkara upasana is the ultimate adhyasa that removes all other adhyasas. Why? Because Omkara is the ultimate. Beyond that, you cannot do any other adhyasa. This is the safe thing, that's why. So now, Omkara is also seen as that itself, as a sound which stands for Brahman. What kind of Brahman? Aparam Brahma and Param Brahma both. What is Aparam Brahma? Ishvara Bhagavan. What is Param Brahma? The truth of Ishvara Bhagavan, which is consciousness. That Brahman which is free of attributes, names and forms. So Brahman in relation to the Jagat, as the ruler of the Jagat, is called Aparam Brahma. Brahman along with Maya Shakti is called Aparam Brahma. And Omkara stands for Aparam Brahma. When you chant Om as a prayer, what are you invoking? Aparam Brahma. When you contemplate upon Om as the truth of yourself, what are you invoking? Param Brahma as yourself, really. So really, when you chant Om, it becomes a upasana. So now, what is this Om we have to see? First, let us look at it linguistically, because it's a clean word in the Sanskrit language. The root verb can be traced to ava, rakshane. Ava means to protect. That which protects is Om. And how do you get that which protects? The agent of protection. There is a suffix for the agent of protection. And that agent of protection suffix is manin. And after, you know, getting chopped off, it becomes man. So what do we have now? Ava plus man. What does it become? Ava man. Yeah. Now there is one rule that whenever ava, the root word ava, contacts the suffix man, you have to change it into u. Okay? So ava becomes what? U. U plus man, uman. Now, there is one more rule saying that the man suffix takes guna. What is the guna for u?
O.
O. So now what do we have?
Oman.
Not the country. Okay? Yeah. Oman. Okay? Then we have the dropping off of the tail. T lopa it is called. The dropping off of the tail. And that last syllable has to be chopped off. What is the last syllable in Oman? An. So when you minus an from Oman, what do you get?
Om.
Om. Om. Om. This is the protector. Very nice, isn't it? This is the protector. This is the agent of protection. And so here, this is a linguistic verb, which means the one who protects, that which protects. And so it stands for Ishvara. And what kind of a name? It's not one more name for Ishvara. Because you see, we have various avatars of Bhagavan. We have incarnations like Shiva, Parvati, you know, all the Vishnu, all these things, Ganesha. Those are all specific things. Correct? Om is the general thing. The general name for Ishvara, not a specific name connected to any form or function. So what do you mean by a general name for Ishvara? General name means that this name, you know, it's like when you have in your computer there are many folders and files, correct? So in one file you keep everything, let's say. You have one file which holds a lot of specific files on the same subject. One is the general file that holds the specific files. So the general file is Om. The specific folders are the various devatas, various forms and functions. So Om stands for Bhagavan, and Om also stands for the consciousness, which is the truth of Bhagavan. So it includes the Jagat. It includes the universe, with all the names and forms, and it also includes that which is free of all names and forms. And the Shastra has loaded, you know, the Om with certain meanings. In the Mandukya Upanishad, the first mantra says, all that is here is Om. Trikale pitishthati tadapi omkar, that which is bhutancha, bhavyancha, bhavatcha, that which is in the past, in the future, now, that which is standing in all three periods of time, unchanging, is Om. And that which is beyond time is also Om. So Om is a general name for Bhagavan. And linguistically, it has the meaning of that which always protects. Now, if the Shastra has coined the word Om to stand for Bhagavan and the whole universe and beyond that as well, then even phonetically it makes a lot of sense, because there are three syllables in Om: A plus U plus M. Don't say M, it's just M, right? And phonetically, linguistically we saw that, phonetically also it makes sense, because the name for Bhagavan has to be universal. It's not your God, my God, it's me God. It's not, oh my God, it's oh me God. So therefore, you cannot have one particular name from a particular culture, from a particular thing. So even linguistically, if it is Sanskrit, phonetically, it should apply to everybody, everywhere. And so phonetically, based on the human voice acoustics, what is the primal sound? What is the first sound that anybody makes if you just open your mouth?
Ah.
Ah. You know? Just open your mouth, make a sound. Ah.
Ah.
That's what will come. Nothing else will come. And then what's the last sound? Last sound means after this fellow closes the mouth finally. Correct? So the beginning and the end is universal. And then you put an oo in the middle to round off all the other syllables in every other language. A plus oo plus m. You must never chant aum. Aum, Aum, no. Why? Because Brahman is one thing. It's a monolith. It's the only thing. It cannot be cut up into regions and things. So grammatically also there is violence. Phonetically also there is violence. And even though we may say A plus U plus M, actually it is Om. A plus U always becomes O. And once that guna operation has taken place, you cannot go back to A plus U. It's only just to think about it, A plus U, and also to see how beautifully the Shastra loads this word Om. It's very nice. And in the Mandukya Upanishad, this Atma is divided into four. What? The indivisible is divided into four? As though. For the sake of understanding. And then it is put alongside the Om, the first syllable, akara, the a sound, stands for the waker. Who is the waker? Hopefully all of you, correct? Right now? This is the waker. Aham, I am the waker, correct? And so the waker is not happening, the waking is not happening in a vacuum. Where is the waking happening? In the Jagat. What kind of a Jagat?
Man.
A manifesting Jagat, correct? So the syllable A stands for the waker and the waking world. This Jagat with all its noise, all its excitement, so many things are happening. And even when nothing is happening, new species are coming, old species are getting extinct. somebody somewhere is getting moksha hopefully, and somebody is again not having got moksha, is being reborn. So much is happening, you know. Still needing some more time on the jagat is reborn. And somebody else is fighting, and somebody else is, you know, cooking up something, and somebody is going to office, and it's like the jagat is like a much larger macrocosm, like the Grand Central Station. Never a dull moment, correct? Always things are going on, things are going on, going on, going on, going on. This is our jagat. So the individual waker is called Vishwa, and the waking universe, which is the corresponding macrocosmic other end of the continuum of the individual waker, the macroscopic representation of the individual waker, is the waking jagat, the waking world, the waking universe is called Virat. Vishwa Virat. And then what is who? Dreamer. The thinking world, the dreamer in relation to the thinking world, or the individual thinker in relation to the thinking world. This is much more subtle, correct? This is the realm of planning. This is the realm of a sukshma realm, a very subtle realm, where the dreaming is happening. And then at the level of the jagat also, at the level of the microcosm, it's the individual thinker or the dreamer. At the level of the macrocosm, we have Hiranyagarbha. The individual dreamer is called Taijasa. Hiranyagarbha, the manifesting universe, the plan behind the manifesting. Like when you see a small shoot ready to just part into two, you see that tiny shoot coming from the earth, you see the baby rays of the sun just struggling to come out from behind the mountain. All this is Hiranyagarbha. It's beautiful. It's that potential to manifest as well as the manifesting universe, that shakti which manifests. And even within the individual, that shakti to create a new world by way of the dream. This is what the individual is called Taijasa, the manifesting jagat, the thinking jagat. Bhagavan in relation to the thinking world has got a name, Hiranyagarbha. Then after waking all day and after dreaming, etc., what does the person want to do? Sleep. Sleep, what happens? Ego resolves. Duality resolves. Fear and sorrow resolve. Samsara resolves. The sleeping world is marked by the absence of knower, known, thinker, thought, dreamer, dreamed. There is only one reality to which the individual ego has finally submitted, accidentally, but you know, submitted, and it is a state of great happiness. And unfortunately, it's also a state of great ignorance, because the person doesn't know I'm so happy. Only in retrospect the person knows. Yes? Yes? And since the person is maha-ignorant in the sleep state, ignorant of oneself, ignorant of the waking world, ignorant of being the truth of the waker, dreamer and sleeper, ignorant of becoming one with Ishvara, so to speak, therefore he is called Prajñaha, Prakarshena Ajñaha, the one who is a lost cause, Ajñani. And then what's on the other side? Ishvara, correct? What is Ishvara in relation to the sleeping world? What is that? Laya. All that is there is one consciousness. We are constrained to give it a name, Ishvara. So why A stands for the waker and U stands for the dreamer and M stands for the sleeper? All these reasons are given in the Mandukya Upanishad, where it says that, you know, it really uses the words, the letters to rhyme, and you know, it is things start with U and things start with M, you know, and all these things. So it's very beautiful, and to a certain extent it's arbitrary. So the waker, dreamer, sleeper, Om. And then after Om, one Om, what comes? Om. What is between one Om? What is after the beginning of one Om and before the beginning of the other Om?
Silence.
Silence. That silence is called Amatra. Amatra means no measure, doesn't, you know, is not counted really. But really that which we don't count is the only thing that counts. Because the truth of the waker is amatra, the truth of the dreamer is resolving into amatra, the truth of the sleeper is amatra, the adhishthana of the whole waking, dreaming, sleeping jagat, you know, Ishvara, Hiranyagarbha and Virat is amatra. Amatra is adhishthana. The other day I explained adhishthana. What is adhishthana? Yeah, the basis of everything, the truth of everything. So in this silence alone is that indicator, see, which is so beautiful. Om. And after some length of chanting, you have to stop. You cannot keep on saying, you start sounding like a bee, you know. And people will say, are you doing Bhramari Pranayama? There is one Pranayama where you make the noise like a bee. So unless you are doing that, you have to stop. Om. You can drag it maybe a little bit. Om. After that you have to stop. Even if you don't want to stop, you are out of breath, you have to stop. And that is where, that is what really matters, because that silence is what upholds the sound. It's a beautiful paradoxy. The silence upholds the sound. Because how will you notice sound otherwise if there is no silence? Correct? If already there is a lot of sound and one more sound happens, you're not going to notice the sound. In silence, sound comes. In silence, sound is cognized. Because of the silence, sound is cognized, and after sound finishes making the sound, where does the sound go? Where does it go? Resolves back into silence. That's a sound answer. So this sound is, you know, sound cannot exist without silence. Time cannot exist without the timeless adhishthana. Time cannot exist. Space cannot exist without spacelessness. All names and forms cannot exist without that which is beyond names and forms. And so who is the silence? What is this silence? And then here, of course, there is another problem, because people start thinking that Brahman is silence. Therefore what? Shh, don't make a sound. If you make a sound, Brahman chale jayega. It, Brahman will go. As long as you are chup, Brahman will be with you. Chup means silent. You be silent, you know. And people talk like this. One time, you know, one person came in the Rishikesh ashram to talk. And, you know, that time Swamiji was there, Swami Dayananji was there. And it was from some other ashram this sadhu came. And so out of respect, Swamiji said, please say a few words, talk about Brahman. You know, they are all Vedanta students, please talk. And this man said, what is there to talk? Brahman is not worth talking about, cannot be talked about, cannot, is communicated only through silence. It's an insult to talk about Brahman. In fact, everybody, if we just kept quiet, we would know Brahman quicker than if we are keeping on talking about it. The problem with Vedanta teachers is that they don't know this. He's saying this. They think that Brahman is communicated through words. Brahman is not communicated through words. Brahman is communicated through silence. Like this, he talked for 2 hours. You know, so this is the problem. They are not understood. The silence is the indicator of Adhishthana. Sound is also Brahman. So if you make a sound, suddenly Brahman is going to get scared and run away because you made a sound. Then which becomes more powerful? The sound becomes more powerful than the silence. This is ridiculous that you have to keep all quiet, otherwise Brahman will go away. With great difficulty I have got Brahman and somehow I have to hang on to it. And if I am quiet, it will stay with me. If I talk, the moment I talk, it will go away. That means Brahman is limited. If sound is opposed to Brahman, Brahman is limited. If silence is opposed to Brahman, Brahman is again limited. Correct? So what we are attempting to reveal through the word Om is that limitless truth of oneself that is not opposed to sound, that is not opposed to silence. Then why are you harping on the silence? I am harping on the silence to show that that in which all the names and forms resolve is silence. Where all the sound of the a, u, m resolve is silence. So that Adhishthana into which all the names and forms resolve is that which is beyond names and forms. So the silence is the indicator in the example of Om. When you finish chanting Om, that silence is the indicator of what? Of that which is beyond all names and forms. And see, in the waker and the waking world, so the waker, the waking world, the jiva and the waking world, and the waking world includes all the whole manifest and manifesting universe, and the dreamer includes the potential to manifest including any individual jiva dreamers, and the sleeper includes the jagat in pralaya and the individual sleeper. What else is left out? Nothing is left out. No individual experience is left out and no universal experience is left out either. So both the exclusive experiences of the individual jivas and the collective experience of the entire jagat is taken into account along with the creator of the jagat. That is the first three sounds, a, u, ma. That's what they stand for. And then all that is an incidental manifestation. The jagat is an incidental manifestation of Brahman. We saw that. Like even the pot is an incidental manifestation of clay. Clay remaining uniquely itself can give rise to the pot, sustain the pot and resolve the pot. So too, Brahman in the form of Ishvara can, you know, give rise to the waking world. In that consciousness, the waking world arises, the thought world arises, and all that is also resolved. Correct? And that resolution is marked by amatra. What is that amatra? Amatra means that not just the resolution in between two cycles of creation, but that ability to stand apart and be uniquely itself, not be chained to these three functions of, you know, srishti, sthiti, samhara, creation, sustenance, dissolution. Or even the waking world, the dream world, the thought world and the sleeping world. So we know that Brahman is not tied to this kind of a chain reality. Like a bullock tied to this oil machine, you know, oil press. On one side you have this big stone, poor thing. On the other side a short chain and a churning rod. And then underneath they put some sesame and the whole thing just keeps going round, the bullock. So this, you replace bullock with Brahman, so then you have Virat, then it becomes Vishwa, then it becomes Daijasa, then it becomes Hiranyagarbha, then it becomes Pragya, then it just keeps going round and round. Oh, poor Brahman, it is tied to the cycles of creation and dissolution. No, that is why the silence indicates the essential nature of Brahman, that which is just indicated by silence. It doesn't mean only in silence you know. In fact, only through words you know. That is what is called Shabda Pramana, the words of the Shastra, handled by a person who knows how to teach. That is what it is called. So therefore, in silence alone it is cognized, you can't say. Or in sound alone it's cognized, you cannot say. That which is unopposed to sound and unopposed to silence. Then why are we talking about the silence? Because we are giving an example. We are loading the syllables a, u, ma and silence to indicate aparam and param brahma. The first three are aparam brahma. Aparam means Bhagavan here. The Bhagavan in relation to the waking world and the individual waker. Because the waking world has to include the individual waker. Otherwise the individual waker will limit Bhagavan. And Bhagavan will limit this jiva. Both are one, both are limitless. This is just from the standpoint of the individual and from the standpoint of the collective. So the individual waker and the waking world are loaded into or correspond to akara, a. The individual thinker and the thought world correspond to u. And the individual sleeper and the whole laya, the lull in between cycles of creation, correspond to m. And after that what comes? That is called turiya. Turiya is short for chaturiya, which means the fourth. Really, it's not the fourth. It is the truth of all three. It is the truth of all three. It's not another state. Because these three you can call states, because one changes to the other. And when one is there, the other two are not there. But the fourth is silently there behind the first one, behind the second one, behind the third one. Always there. That which upholds the first one, two and three is called Turiya. It is there. It is the invariable presence of that consciousness which morphs, as it were, into the waker and the waking world, the dreamer and the dream world, the sleeper and the sleep world, while being none of the three. Do you see why? In the example, the silence is an indicator of that. And since we cannot name it, since we cannot objectify it, since it can only be understood because it is self-evident, we just give it the name Turiya. That's all it is. Chaturiya, that's all. Fourth means not the fourth, like 1, 2, 3, 4, not a discrete enumeration. But fourth here means that which stands apart from the other three. That which is the truth, the adhishthana of the other three. See how beautiful the Omkara is? So one chants Om, Om, Om. Om, 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 Om. So this is the, when you are chanting now, your emphasis is where? On chant, on the chant. Now let us chant again, and this time you put the attention on the silence between the two chants, and you see the emphasis totally changes. So does the mood that it invokes. Om, 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 Om. Do you see that? The whole emphasis changes. In the first, it was more of a dynamic person that was invoked. I am the one who is chanting. Correct? And then never mind about the silence. When is the next chant coming? Om, Om, Om. Correct? And in the second one, if you noticed, that the space between the chants was threatening to get longer and longer. Because one likes to be in that space so much. One loves to be in that space. It's such a beautiful space. You want to elongate it. You want to elongate it. Correct? Yeah. So, and then in the first one, the focus was on the next chant, the next chant, the next chant. And here the focus was on this silence, this silence, this silence. There was nothing next. The next one with great difficulty you would say Om, and then again this silence here, now. You see, that is what is Turiya. And how beautiful this one monosyllabic word stands for the entire Jagat and its Adhishthana. Stands for the waker and the waker's Adhishthana, the sleeper and the sleeper's Adhishthana. So really speaking, the silence is not just at the end of Om. What is upholding the A? The silence. U, the silence is upholding the U. The silence is upholding the U. So Om. So when you say Om, when you meditate upon Om, you can visualize, I mean, in fact, even if you don't visualize, you have this sensation of the Jagat bursting forth from Ishvara, really. Just like the chant is bursting forth from you. And then, everything comes to a place of repose as it is. The truth behind it, which is yourself alone. So it's not that the silence is empty. The silence is the fullness. The silence is everything. The silence is Purna. That is your nature. The silence is not an empty silence. Oh my God, what should I do next? No. That is only for people who don't understand this. For people who understand Om, the silence is total. That silence is that totality of all the three states. That statelessness is the silence. The one that is unchanging, in whom everything comes, in whom everything lives, in whom everything dissolves. That one which quietly does its job, supports the three states, itself doesn't even have a name, doesn't even have a form. That is what is the Om. And so, you see, this is why it is called Shreshtham Alambanam, Etad Alambanam Shreshtham. Kathopanishad, Lord Yama says that. And Yama should know what he is talking about, correct? Yeah. Etad alambanam param. This is the best way, this is the most exalted way, because by one word we include both param and aparam brahma. And that one word is both the means and the end. How beautiful is that? It's the means to reach Bhagavan. And who is the reacher? Bhagavan. What is reached? Bhagavan. And so, therefore, the chanting of the Om, they say, that drops things off. It gives vairagya. Why? Because there is, as a mantra, there is a blessing, correct? And it brings its own fruit. Every mantra brings its own fruit. And so the chanting of Om by itself as a mantra, you know, gives vairagya. Vairagya means you feel sick of this world, of life. And you feel like running away to the Himalayas or joining a 3-year course somewhere. If you are not ready to do that, don't chant just Om. This is what is advised. Yeah, because then you will be neither here nor there. You can chant Om, but put it along with a name for Sagunam Brahma, like Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Dakshinamurtaye, Om Dum Durga Yai Namaha, like this. So you chant along with a, you know, avatara of Bhagavan, so that chanting of Om will give the blessings of Vairagya, but it will also keep you grounded, so that you don't run away when you are not ready to run away. This is what it is. And then they made up a few more rules, you know. Few more rules means what? Women should not chant Om. Any guesses who made the rule? Who might have made that rule? Not women, correct? Yeah. Yeah. Why? Because as I told you, when you chant Om, 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 you feel like getting up and leaving. Already when we chanted, when we had a little mini, you know, Omkara session here, nobody wanted to even talk. Everybody wanted to extend the silence. And so therefore, when you keep chanting Om, 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 you feel like getting up and going away. And if the women, all the women were to keep chanting Om, then who will cook? Because they will get up and go away. Who will clean? who will take care of the men and help them to chant Om? Nobody. So therefore they made this rule. And same thing with the prayer called Shri Rudram. Women should not chant Rudram because it gives Vairagya. Yeah. It gives total objectivity. And you see all the dysfunctional ways in which you are caught in things and you just feel like dropping it. So they say, they made these rules, don't chant Om, don't chant Rudram, don't chant Gayatri Mantra, all these things, you know. To ensure their three meals, they made this rule. That's all it is. No such rule. It gives Vairagya, that is true. And that is the precise reason the sannyasi is told to chant Om. The householder is told to not chant Om because you should not leave the household if you are not ready for it. And the sannyasi should not come back to the household after renouncing everything. So keep maintaining your Vairagya. Keep chanting Om all the time. That is really the only mantra. There is another mantra, but really speaking, that is the main thing the sannyasi is asked to do. Kalam Nayet Nirantaram. Because we don't want you to come back. With great difficulty you have gone. Stay there now. Whether the sannyasi is relieved after taking sannyasa or not, the householders are happy. Why? Because they have got sannyasa from the sannyasi. So therefore, you know, don't come back. You stay in your sthana and let us stay in our sthana. And so you keep chanting Om. And we will keep chanting Om Namah Shivaya or any, attach it. Om Ishaya Namaha, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, any mantra. You know, this is what we will do. So this is the power of Omkara. It is not an ordinary mantra. That is why Etad Eva Alambanam Param. And also another thing. You can't really chant Om without knowing the meaning of the word Om. You can't use a mantra for upasana without knowing the meaning, correct? And there was one group of people that was giving meaningless sounds for mantra. And then you would ask the followers of this group, what does the mantra mean? Oh, it's just a meaningless sound. How can a meaningless sound become, you know, mantra? Mantra means mananat trayate iti mantra, that which protects upon repeated contemplation. So for it to have the power to protect, I should know what it means, correct? So you cannot chant Om, two things. You cannot chant Om without knowing the meaning. So that's why I had to tell you the meaning here. And number two, you cannot chant Om without really seeing the meaning as yourself, correct? You cannot say Om is describing the glories, Ananta Kalyana Gunaha, you know. The describing the glories of some Bhagavan sitting somewhere in Kailasa, sitting somewhere in Vaikuntha. Kailasa and Vaikuntha are Indian versions of heaven. You know, we have many heavens, yeah. One for Shiva, one for Vishnu. We have many, many heavens. One for the ancestors, like this. So it's not that, you know, this Om, the Omkara is not invoking some Bhagavan located somewhere. That Bhagavan is located in the very buddhi that is chanting Om. In fact, the buddhi that is illumining Om itself is illumining this whole jagat. That light of consciousness, which is, you know, blessing the buddhi, is illumining the entire jagat and illumining its truth as well. So therefore, when you say Om, you cannot disinclude yourself, correct? So therefore, it is the ultimate upasana. And Omkara Upasana here is advised to Ashvalayana because Prajapati thought that Ashvalayana is fit for plain Omkara meditation. And even if it is not plain Omkara meditation, you can use any mantra which begins with Om. All mantras begin with Om, even the Gayatri mantra. Om Tatsa Viturvare Enyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Dhiyo Yonav Prachodayat. That also includes Om. And since Om has only three matras, you cannot elongate it. In some ashrams, people chant it like a siren. You know, you feel like there is some kind of tornado coming. Om, and it never ends. That's not correct. Om, Om, Om. This is what it is. So now Ashvalayana is given this mantra here by the teacher, not as a meditation, not for gaining Aparam Brahma, but for what? But for understanding the truth of himself as Param Brahma, as non-separate from Brahma. And so any aid that helps you see the truth of the teachings is called contemplation. It is not meditation. Because Om is a word from the Shastra whose meaning, when you understand, it reveals your own meaning. And so recalling that meaning again and again, what does it do? It firms up the teaching in the heart. So suppose there is a heart, for whatever reason, perhaps it is a little stubborn, perhaps there is resistance, perhaps there is a block, or perhaps for some reason one cannot see something, for, you know, there is some unconscious coming in the way, and so therefore what? Therefore the Omkara Upasana is advised, the contemplation is advised, and usually the contemplation is not, does not produce the, why usually, at any time, the contemplative practices, we have to understand what is contemplation, the contemplative practices do not produce knowledge. What produces knowledge? Shravanam, listening. Shravanam eva jnanasya mukhya sadhanam, the primary way of gaining the teaching, gaining the knowledge is called shravanam. That is the only way really. And if, and Shravanam will work, how can it not work? It is working, it does work. But supposing one feels that my knowledge is covered or shrouded in doubt, vagueness and error, then one is asked to do mananam, doubt removal, which is what we have at the end of each class. Doubt removal. Any questions, I will say. Yes, how do we do this? What do we do here? How do we go about this? This is what is, you know, doubt removal. Then, okay, the doubts are gone. What should be, is the object of meditation is gone. Why should I meditate is gone. What is this knowledge is gone. Who is to be known is gone. And is Bhagavan myself or part of myself or what? All that, those doubts are gone. But still I find that as soon as I finish the class, what happens? I am back to the normal jiva life. Yeah. In class, I have an expanded consciousness, as though consciousness can expand more than it is. But this is how people talk. My consciousness expands in class and then it crunches back after class. It's not consciousness that expands or crunches back. What is it? It is the buddhi. Yeah. So, whatever it is, in class I have this expansive feeling, and after class all the day-to-day things come and rob me of the fruits of knowledge. I have the knowledge, I have the clarity, but there appears to be a disconnect between the, what I know and how I behave. And that disconnect can be there in all branches of knowledge, correct? And in fact, it is there in most all branches of knowledge. This disconnect is there in all disciplines. The teacher of microbiology, after teaching microbiology for 10 years, is not suddenly converted into a microbe. You know, the students are looking everywhere, where is the teacher? And a voice comes from the floor, look here, I'm here. And a small little bug with little pair of glasses is walking into the classroom. This was the, you know, the professor who has become one with microbiology. You know, this never happens. Why? Because all branches of knowledge, aparavidya, means it is a talking of objects and disciplines other than yourself, correct? It is the study of the relative. But paravidya, the study of the absolute, has to include you. And therefore the Mundaka Upanishad, which gives these distinctions between para and apara, the relative and the knowledge of the relative and the knowledge of the absolute as yourself, also says at the end, brahmavid brahmaiva bhavati, the knower of Brahman becomes Brahman. Becomes? What was the he or she before? Before a Brahman and now Brahman? No. Becomes is within heavy quotes. Becomes means in one's awareness becomes. Like the pauper became a prince. There was a movie, The Prince and the Pauper. And we have our own story like that. And in our version of the story, there was a terrible coup at the time of, you know, at the time of a king, when the king was reigning and when the prince was still a baby. And the king and his wife, the queen, knew that they were going to perish, that the army was really bad and the other king was going to completely, that they had surrounded the kingdom and they were going to kill them. And they didn't want the prince to die. So what did they do to the prince? They put him in a basket, covered him with old leaves and sent him along with the nurse and the minister to a safe place to be brought up like an ordinary boy in the village. Okay? So that later on, after all this went, and then the minister, who was very faithful, had promised the king that even if you lose your life, I will fight back these enemies. I will reinstate the prince regent and I will make him rule this kingdom even after you. Unfortunately, the nurse and the minister, as they are, you know, fleeing the kingdom to go to some remote village, get into a big fire, you know, there's some kind of a fire and some kind of an ambush. And they are separated from the prince. The basket is left somewhere and they flee for their lives. They all survive, but they lose the basket. Then the minister who had made the king, of course, perishes in this war. And the army is now the new king is very tyrannical and horrible. And the minister is feeling very guilty now. Why? Because he had given the word to the king. And he keeps looking for the prince. And he keeps praying for this prince to be alive and well wherever he is and for him to be united with this prince. 5 years pass by and then he comes upon a group of playing urchins who are fighting for some thing from the garbage. And then he recognizes the prince because the prince had some birthmark in the neck behind. And he recognizes the shape. He makes this child sit on his lap. He recognizes the birthmark. And he says, this indeed is the prince. So he takes him to the barber, gets his hair cut, you know, gives him, dips him in a flea bath. Because he was a roadside urchin for all these years, you know. And gives him royal finery, you know, cleans him up and puts him on the palanquin, you know, that they carry. And then he says, now all these tyrannical offenders, you step down because you think there was no heir and now you are occupying the throne. The heir has been found and is going to be ceremonially brought to the palace at such and such a time. The town criers announce very well. And then the whole street, the whole town, the whole kingdom comes out to see and receive this prince. They are so happy, they are sick of this king. And the mantri says, the minister says, I will, you know, under my guidance, he will rule. Just like the king, I ruled, you know, the king ruled under, you know, also. And the king taught me the ways. And so the prince will rule until he reaches majority. I will be the, you know, one who is guiding him. And so this is, you know, they have to vacate the throne. And so the whole town comes to greet this prince. To their horror, what does the prince do? The palanquin, the procession passes through the streets and the prince sees another garbage can. He jumps down from the palanquin. And what does he do? Sifts through the garbage can, finds some bread and fish and piece of fish that just, you know, scaly pieces that people have thrown. And some stale bread, chapati, and he's eating it. And the minister is horrified. What are you doing? You are Maharaj, you are a prince. You cannot do all this. Will I have fish? You will have the finest fish in the whole kingdom. In fact, all the fishes will come to you only. Will I have bread? You will have bread from all over the world. Come, sit back here. You know, again he cleans him up. Again he sits back. And then again down the road he sees a few more people fighting for something. He gets off and does this again. This is what is called viparita bhavana. So one doesn't become Brahman, just like the pauper doesn't become prince. The pauper was always the prince. The pauper, you know, that he was a pauper was a superimposition upon the princely, upon his princely being. So too the Atma is always Brahman. That the Brahman, you know, thinks of itself as the pauper jiva is the problem. And so when this problem comes, this is called viparita bhavana. It's not that the boy doesn't know I am prince, but he forgets, because there is a habitual orientation that is going against that. So therefore the Omkara Upasana is that contemplation which restores, you know, which removes that superimposition completely, takes away the viparita bhavana and restores oneself back to oneself. More we will see after a short 8-minute break. Thank you. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.